I think I need more chalk. Oh, okay. Okay, let's begin. Already, this thanks to the servant that we have all the main theorem proven. But let me explain my point of view of operator algebras. Okay, my view is the following. Okay. You recognize natural numbers, 1, 2. Thanks to your ancestor, you are at 0. That's definitely the India's the contribution to this world. Well, the Maya, the Mexican did it, but that tradition didn't continue. It disappeared. We have that zero found by Indian. And then come to the integers. And then they come to the rational numbers, real numbers, complex numbers. Okay, up to this point, the whole world is very nice, happy. But when the quantum physics started in the turn of the last century, the commutative world of number is no longer adequate. And at the same time, the matrices algebra is not enough either. And then operator algebra comes in to include, to give the mathematical frame, the number system. Okay, that's the what we need to describe our environment, the quantum physics. And the mathematics, unfortunately, when it comes to this world, we have only right now, I think, 29, so for 80 years. It's not long enough, like others, those are 1,000 years old. So, we used to live in that long. Our experience is with operator algebra only 80 years. So we have to explore more and more. And that's what we are at this position. And that's the John von Neumann was the hero. And Murray is a collaborator. And then afterwards, many people jumped into that field, and there have been the up and down, and so on and so forth. And now, I think there's so many miracles in operator algebra, which really convinced me that operator algebra is the one which will never die, no matter what. For instance, this condition, very simple relation for the postulate of C-star algebras. Then what happened is the C-star algebra to purely algebraic star isomorphism gives you immediately isomorphism isometry. Okay, that's norm structure and the algebraic structure is very tightly connected. Okay, that's an amazing fact here. Proof is not that simple, but it is the fact. At the same time, when you represent the C-star algebra into the pi on over the Hilbert space, and pi away weak closure, you get the phonemic algebra. Okay? Then what's happened is that the unit ball take weak closure, then you get unit ball of M. Okay? Weak closure, it's a very mysterious that the pointwise convergence is then that the stereo norm is under control. If you look for the, any other mathematical field, that you don't have that much that type of structure, that's a very tight structure there. Okay, actually, these two facts convinced me to stay on the operator algebra. When I was young, there's the period of very down, very few papers appears. I waited in the library for the new paper comes. And when it comes in, like that. For instance, I can still remember the excitement I had when I found a CADIS on the transitivity theorem, which shows that if C-star algebra acts on Hilbert space irreducibly, namely topologically, no invariant subspace, then algebraically it's transitive. Okay, that's what he proved. Okay, that's confirming those tight structure there. Okay. Now, well, I don't want to talk about the operator algebras, but we need to work. But my goal in that respect is to convince you whenever you have monomial algebra M and the Hilbert space H on which M acts, then this is indeed L2 object. Okay, whatever that meaning is, I want to clarify why is this L2 object. And also, you have another Banach space associated with M is the predial. That is L1 object. Okay, in the normal major theory, you talk about LP of XM, mu, and LQ, ox, mu. I'm sure some of you learned here sometime you consider intersection of them, that is the function which is p's power integrable and q's power integrable, etc. However, as soon as you're bringing in some extra structure such as transformation or coordinate change in x, coordinate change, then LP space coordinate change rule, LQ space coordinate change rule are different. When you have a transformation T in the LP space, you have to consider this Radon derivative P through the bit, right, for the coordinate change. For this one, you have to change the coordinate using that quantity. So vector space, this obey that rule, vector space obey that rule, then coordinate change rule differs. That means we are a totally different object. And if you are a physicist, you don't add mass and the temperature. Okay, you don't add or the weight and the temperature. No, that doesn't match. They're totally different the quantity. Here is the same. LP and LQ, they're different objects. So I have to make question here. Very much on that. And when you go to the operator algebraic LP spaces, the intersection disappears. Okay, for instance. Now, that is, now, this morning, the morning we talked about a lot that this X in M, X xi naught, right? Okay, what is this? Okay, this is indeed, if you look at, then this object must be square root of phi zero. And then if you write this to be xi, x is xi to the minus 1/2. And it's okay. This is just L1. This is, L2. L2 the canceling. So this is L0, 0. Okay, that's 0 is the operator. But not necessarily bounded. This can be unbounded. So you have to use all muscle to how to define the, when this x being bounded. The m can accommodate only the bounded operator. Okay? So today, okay, now, when you talked about m prime, and we also talked on y prime xi 0, then what is y prime? Okay, that is phi to the minus 1/2 xi. Oh, excuse me. Yeah, so this goes to the right. So m prime, okay, if you look, change the multiplication rule, the anti-isomorphic object, then the MN bimodule, and so goes into the left side. And delta to the ITX, well, actually that depends on the P, minus IT, you write the sigma tau phi. This should be written phi to the pi. Okay, so the goal is to give the meaning to the symbol power phi to the pi our IT. And also, well, you have already this object, so you have that. Okay, so what is this mysterious? Now, at this point, unfortunately, unlike the Serban theory, we cannot go to the p to the power it straight. We have to go through the all modular theory, thanks to this. So we have to rely on the Professor Stratler's lecture, 10 lectures. And what we are going to do is on top of that, okay? And that is my goal, okay? Philosophically, that to give the meaning for that kind of a vague dream. Okay. Unfortunately, the operator algebra is such that the very little shortcut. It's you have to go through the train your muscle to. So first, okay, the symbol M is always for Neumann algebras. And which is the del of it's a uniquely determined Banach space. Okay, that's called the predial. And then the agenda is group of automorphism of M. It's M to M bijection bijections such that alpha x star equal to alpha x star, alpha x y equal to alpha x, alpha y. Being bijection, you can talk about the inverse, as inverse has also the same property. So those are called automorphism. And that's, well, if you are talking of the general automorphism, those are star automorphism, but we consider only star automorphism, so I'm not talking about. Now, being infinite dimensional, we need a topology on this one. Just like operator algebra M, it has several topologies. Okay, of course you can talk about alpha and main norm, supremum, alpha x, beta of x, norm of x is less than equal to one. That's a make it a complete metric group. The invariant, two-sided invariant metric, okay. But this topology is too strict, okay. Oh, one more terminology. Group of inner automorphism here, if alpha of x is written by u, u is in the unitary group of m, that's certainly the inner automorphism. That's a set of u star u equal to 1 equal to u u star. All right. With relative to this, int M is open and closed subset of groups. So it's and the connected component. This is too strict. And we need a more relaxed natural topology. Often you take the alpha I of x converges to alpha of x for all x m, say sigma strongly. But it's not good topology, unfortunately. And the topology we should take is the following, okay? the index by a predial element, which is a set of beta, such that omega I circle I, omega I circle beta less than or equal to 1, omega I circle alpha inverse, omega I circle beta inverse less than 1. Okay, this is the topology we need. Well, if you like, you can take it this epsilon, but if you don't restrict the norm of omega, then you don't need the epsilon. Just the one is small enough if you increase the norm size of omega. Okay, this is the topology in auto M. Okay. And then this makes auto M topological group. And when M predial is separable, then auto M is a Polish group. It is separable, it admits separable and a complete metric. But the mark is the group of inner morphism, which is a normal subgroup, need not be closed. Group of inner morphism not necessarily closed. And there is an important factor which we have a time we explore, that in M, closure is all auto M. If M is of AFD, approximately finite dimensional, and 2-1 over 3-1. The 3-1, forget about at the moment, okay? We are not yet talking about 3 times further. But so you do have this, this phenomena in the important case. So it's not just exceptional, okay? So at the same time, there is a case where the interval M is closed. When it is, if you have M is generated by Fn, n larger than or equal to, well, or n, if n equals to 1, that's abelian. So there's no inner automorphism anyway. Free group generated by the left regular representation of Fn, then the interm is closed. So the closeness of the group of inner automorphism is plays an important role. So this was investigating. It's not a weak point of the non-closeness. It's going to provide you, some tool to work on. In other words, that if interval is all automorphism, all automorphism approximately inner, so how it, you approximate. That is the kind of the technique available. Now, so that's that much about the general topology, topological property of the group of automorphisms. So now we are going to talk about the group because we have to work on the automorphism group, so group G. Locally compact group. Okay, we can spend a whole year talking about locally compact group or D group, etc., which we don't. So those who are not familiar with it, then you assume this to be real rank. That is the most relevant to us anyway. So, and DS, DT, or sometimes DG is the Hall measure, left invariant Hall measure. Okay. And now, okay, if I write L of G is the Hilbert space of a square integrable functions relative to the left Hall measure. So what you assume is F integration over G F S T D S equal to F of dt equals f of t dt, and g f of t st ds equals to delta gt of f of st ds. Okay, so that's the left Hall measure. Okay, if it is non-unimodular, you have modular function. Okay. Now, and over this, you have lambda g of s psi of t to be psi s inverse of t psi is in L2 over g, and rho sub g of s psi of t equal to delta g of s to the minus one, I think minus one half ts. Those signs I never be secure all the time. So, and those are the left regular representation and the right regular representation. And okay, action. Alpha of G is a map from G to alpha sub S to the automorphism group of M, such that alpha ST equal to alpha S alpha T. That's a composition of the, of two maps, okay, composition. And we demand this to be continuous. Okay, for the real line, you have instead with the S plus T. Okay. So we write this is M and G and alpha. That's what we call it covariant system. More precisely, you make a von Neumann covariant system because you have a C-star algebra case. When you are in the C-star algebra setting, the group action, then you don't have a predial at hand. So the topology is not the right one. So for the C-star covariant system, you fix a C-star algebra group and action. In that case, you demand norm goes to zero as S goes to the identity for all X. Oh, excuse me, this is X. For X in A. Okay. So, the phoneme algebra case, when you have action, you don't expect this whole X in M. So you have that the continuous portion, say A alpha, X in M, such that alpha S of X minus X goes to zero as S goes to the identity. When you are real line, S goes to zero, okay. Then it is easy. This is a sigma weak dense, sigma weakly dense C-star subalgebra of M. Okay, how do you prove that this is dense? It is the following. When you have in L1 of G, L1, that means integrable F, integral over G, that's finite, that's L1. Okay, this is. And if you have that such a function, if you can make this, you can integrate alpha s against function f. So as soon as you have this and alpha s, first of all, the property this alpha s f has, alpha f has, is the following. Alpha f of x, let's look at it. Norm of integral over g, rf of s, alpha s of x ds, norm. Oh, it's less than equal to I mentioned to you automorphism always isometry. Okay, that isomorphism isometry. So this is norm of X ds over g. You can throw this out. It's norm of 1 and norm of x. So this one is bounded by norm of f1, L1 norm of f times x. The operator norm, alpha f, is bounded by f L1. Alpha f is the linear transformation of M. Okay, operators of operator. So with this now, if you look at that, then it's very easy to see that alpha s applied to alpha f equal to alpha lambda sf. Lambda is this Or maybe you write this here. Well, that's a too heavy notation. So that means that there are alpha lambda SF minus alpha F. That's not bounded by, oh, excuse me, lambda. That's lambda sub S F minus F 1. Okay, the left translation on L1 space is a norm continuous in L1 norm. So this goes to 0 as S goes to the identity. Okay, and also now you discover that if you take function, okay, neighborhood of E, and here's a U, F of U is a positive function such that F of U, on a norm, okay, then integral equal to 1. Then this FU converges to the delta function, right? And alpha F of X, my FU, 0 when U goes down to E. As a neighborhood system, as a directed set. So that shows that no, excuse me. No, not in norm. I meant is goes to 0 relative to phi of and okay, that you take. So that shows the system dynamic system. You can choose dense system dynamic system inside von Neumann covariant system, okay, which is very important. For example, it comes, well, I don't think I'm going to prove anything like that. If you have the M to be the algebra of all essential bounded functions on the standard measure space, and if you have group G acts on M by alpha, then alpha S of F of X equal to F of T S inverse of X. Okay, T of S is a non-singular null set preserving map. Okay, and T S T T X equal to T S T X almost everywhere, right? Not every X, almost everywhere. Null set ambiguity always sitting there. But this is the typical operator algebraist trick to the conventional ergodic theorist that we take the following. If you have alpha dot, A alpha, that's the system dynamical system on which G act in the following way, that aloha SX converges to zero when S go to any. So this is the set of those X. We know this A-alpha is sigma weakly dense or strongly dense in M, L infinity of X. Now, identity is there. Thanks to the Gelfand, A-alpha is the C of omega, omega compact set. If you like, if in this case, you can choose a little bit smaller algebra such that A naught is separable. You can make it a separable one as well. And of course, G has to be separable. And this omega become metrizable compact set, compact space. And then thanks to this, what that means, aloha S of X of T S inverse of omega now this is a homeomorphism and the map from G cross omega to is the jointly continuous. So it's much, you can, you are very comfortable because it is not almost everywhere, it's a point-wide true statement now, for instance. Okay? So, and if you have that measure mu, you have a probability measure mu sits on here as a random measure. And which is left absolutely continuous.
How would the A0 chosen? How is A0 chosen?
You can first choose countable dense subset, okay? And then you translate the all countable subset by a dense subset of L1 of G. Okay, I told you, G is, of course, you are talking of a separable group, right? So this one has a dense set. So you say, shift everybody by those countable set, and then generate C star algebras. And then you see that C star algebra is an invariant under the action of G. Those are the trick to choose separable one. And yet it is sigma weakly dense in the algebra M. So with this overcome that kind of a problem. Or indeed, this is the trick, you know, when Alan did not know this simple trick when he was struggling on 3-0 factor actually to prove the, if you have 3-1 factor, which, well, but this is a background story, the 3-1, and then your core, you have to show is at 2 infinity factor. Okay. To do that, you have to show the triviality on the center of N, on which real line act on the flow. But to show that flow is trivial, you have to show the non-trivial automorphism moves somewhere in a significant way. Which with this major theoretic one, you cannot do that because real line is a continuum. You choose null set, you translate by real line. Nobody guarantees you that is still null. with the real line continuum. Major theory is only respect countable operation, not a continuous operations. So he was unable to conclude that the 3-1 case, the center is trivial. Okay, and well, myself also quite a while struggled how to prove the triviality of real line acting on the center. But this very kind of a very standard track after you realize it. Settles that the topological transformation of real line, no question. If the real line moves something at some point, and the neighborhood has to be moved also. Okay. Mm-hmm. In fact, this is maybe a good point to make. Okay. Traditionally, in the math, the course for math major student, we take a point as the point of departure, point and set. Right, that's teach the set theory at the very early stage of the game. And the point, set, function. But if you look at actual reality, what you observe is not a point. Point is, if you talk to the children, what is the point? You have only position. No area, it's just, et cetera, like, it's an idealized object. But what you see is actually function over the set, if that anything exists underneath. For operator algebraic, what we have is an operator or the element of C-star algebra. And the point comes afterwards as an idealized object, namely the spectrum of commutative C-star algebra, if you are talking about the point. Okay? And so when you start from C-star algebra point of view and develop, say, major theory, then immediately you realize that all those pathological major space disappear, such as the major space with, the one or zero, nothing in between. That such a major space is unavoidable if you start from point. But if you start from C-star algebra and then a positively near functional, then you end up with always good major, that not a major which has only one value, one and zero, and no value in between. Such a thing doesn't occur in the C-star algebra theory, although a positively near functional. And it is more to the closer to the reality because we are observing the function first, and then point becomes, depends on how you approximate your point. That's a spectrum. Okay, so that is what our actually philosophy behind it is. Now, let's say, now suppose you have MG alpha covariance system. And we want to capture the action of alpha within the operator algebras in the language operator. To do that, you have the called closed product. Mm-hmm. it is written as M clause. Okay, the construction is the following. Fix alpha, of course. And then represent M on the Hilbert space H. Okay, then you make Hilbert space L2 H valued function, square integrable function such that psi that from G to H measurable psi of S square ds, say for square root, that's equal to the norm. Oh, often you write this as the H tensor product with L to G. Okay, this is the Hilbert space on which the cross product will be represented. You define in the action how M acts on this space. You have to evaluation at S equal to alpha S. Twist X by alpha S inverse. And UG of S, oh, why don't I, okay. Of T equal to xi T inverse, no, S inverse. Okay. If you are dealing with real line, please interpret this as a T minus S. Okay. If you are talking, thinking everything in terms of real line, then that's a xi T minus S. Okay. Now, so you have. Okay. Let's look at how it acts. U G S R pi alpha of X U sub G S star xi applied to T. This will be pi alpha of X xi, oh no, U G S inverse psi of S inverse T, pi alpha is according to this, equal to alpha S inverse T inverse of X, U G S inverse of xi of S inverse of T, and this one disappears. And so this is alpha T inverse alpha S of S of xi of T. Okay, so that's what you have. And then this is going to be alpha, okay. You can write this way, right? So this is pi alpha applied to alpha S of X and xi evaluated at T. So, in other words, this U sub G, this unitary representation, implements the action alpha of G, alpha S of G. This is true for S in G, X in M. And the cross product is then is this pi alpha of m union usg of group g double commutant. Therefore, Neumann algebra generated by those two type of operators, types of operators, all right? Now, immediate question is that what happens if you represent M on the different Hilbert space? And then do the same, do we have isomorphic cross product? If you do that, that depends on the Hilbert. Is that depend on, does it depend on the how M acts on Hilbert space? Okay, well, okay, we possibly it's good to have a proof for that. This also shows the power of the operator algebras too. So let's consider this. So let's represent M on H1 and M on the H2. So same for Neumann algebra. In other words, there's isomorphism, okay? And write this one by pi 1, pi 2 vex. Both pi 1 and pi 2 are faithful normal representation of M. Here's then a big theorem in the basic theory of Neumann algebra comes in. Pi unit ball, well, if it is normal, that's automatically sigma weakly continuous. Pi 1 of unit ball is sigma weakly compact. It is a compact. Kaplansky density theorem right away tells you that that is the unit ball of the weak closure. And the weak closure does not, so its range is again non-manageable. Okay? So, pi 1, and now you form the following H1 direct sum H2, that is your H. Now, you have to let M act on M, H. It's only natural, so pi of X zero, zero, pi two X diagonally acts X on M. All right? Then what happened is the following. X in M, pi of X in L of H, that's the direct sum Hilbert space. This is again normal because each of them is normal. Okay, but that's the sigma weakly continuous. Hence, it's a unit ball is sigma weakly compact and it is for non-manageable. So, in other words, this is isomorphism. And if you consider E1 to be 1, 0, 0, 0, E2 to be 0, 0, 0, 1, projection to the H1, and other is projection to the second component, H2. Pi 1 of X is nothing but pi of x cut down by E1, or you will have E1. Pi 2 of x is pi of x e2. In other words, pi x 2, pi of x ei, I equal to 1 to 2, is isometry, isomorphism. Okay? The isomorphism. When this is k, when, so pi 1 of x equal to 0 if and only if x equal to 0. This means, first of all, E1, EI, the both projection is pi of m prime in the commutant. Okay? And the pi 1 of x0, x equal to 0, only that one, is that central support of EI in the prime, in the commutant, has to be 1. Right? Central support has to be 1. That's the way, because central support, the orthogonal complement, precisely the kernel of that reduction mapping. That's in this x to the xe1, which commute then, when this is 0, x, that's the central support in the prime. So that means that U E1 U star U runs in the pi of M or the unitary group of pi of M prime equal to 1. Both of them equal to 1. Okay. Now you move to the Hilbert space on which cross product acts. Now, so let's write it in a pi of m cross product r ha g, pi 1 of m cross product r ha g, pi 2 of m cross product and g. If you look at actually the what's going on, the construction, all right, your Hilbert space, L2 h-valued function is L2 direct sum of range split and Hilbert space split nicely, and this this projection to this one is F1 equal to E1 tensor product identity over L2 of G. F2, E2. Then use very quickly notice pi alpha applied to pi of X, the cut down by F1 is precisely pi alpha applied to pi 1 of x, and the pi alpha circle pi of x cut down by f2 is precisely pi alpha pi 2 of x. Okay, now f1 on the F1 and the translation, okay, U sub G acts on the L2 of G translation, not on the Hilbert space H1 component. Hilbert space component doesn't do anything. So those all belong to pi of pi of M, oh, pi M cross product by G, the commutant. It's commute with them. And its central support, UF1 U star equal to 1, because here you have the E1 portion is 1. So the central support of F1, it's 1.
Why did the
What?
Why is that central support of that projection is 1?
Why this one is equal to 1?
Yeah.
That because pi 1 equal to the pi 1 of x equal to 0 if and only if x equals 0, if and only if pi of x equal to 0. So when you have fundamental algebra M, M prime, choose e to the projection of M prime, x e equal to 0 if and only f, x times v u e star equal to 0 for u in the unitary of M prime. Okay, those are the called induction or deduction. So that's what it is. Okay? Otherwise you can see right away. So another words, in a way, this E1 representing E1 and E2. If we look at actually the spatial Hilbert space level, they were kind of consisting of the unitary equivalent component. The number might be different. Okay? The number multiplicity might be different, but still they are all the unitary equivalent if you decompose into the further little piece. That is actually the heart of matter for Murray and von Neumann that studied at the ring of operators, say, 1. And, well, George Markey was not that happy with the dimension theory of von Neumann, Murray and von Neumann. He had to develop his own theory to deal with the unitary representation of a group. Okay, so this is the trick. Well, it is, and indeed, it is, you are talking about actually the heart of the matter. It is very important to make yourself happy with this type of statement. Okay, it's not just nonsense, it's a very important question. Okay, where we are? Okay, so. That another one, so because this, the central support for F1 in the commutant equal to 1, this cutting down is indeed isomorphism for the cross product. So this establishes that pi of M cross product to G, alpha G, is isomorphic to pi 1 of m, alpha g, which is also isomorphic to pi 2 of m, plus to the g. So in other words, the cross product of von Neumann algebras, algebraic type, does not depends on which Hilbert space you represent M. You can choose any Hilbert space you like, as long as action is faithful. Okay, if you have a kernel, then it will be a problem. So, cross product is now well established. No, it's well, two actions are conjugate when you have very natural correspondence on the one system to another. Okay. Now, if you have M G alpha and N G beta, then we call it alpha is conjugate to beta if there is sigma from isomorphism of N. I write range always on the left and the domain on the right, okay? So that when you compose two maps, the middle term disappears, okay? Otherwise, if you write to the left, the reverse it, you, the outside you have to drop it. That's why it's not a good practice and such that M to N, so alpha S, sigma, okay, go back from N to M, and then send it back to N, so that is beta S for all S. Then you call it its conjugate. Okay, now now we'll fix M G alpha, and you consider following map U of S in U unitary. Well, you usually assume this is strongly continuous. You don't assume normal continuous, strongly continuous, okay? Such that U of S, ST equal to U of S, alpha S of U of T. It's called co-cycle identity. Co-cycle identity, okay? And then you have the following. Add U of S following alpha of S, you make it, well, you write this alpha sub U apply to S, okay? Then, this co-cycle identity is precisely the things you needed for the homomorphism property. Equal to alpha UST. Indeed, you can even bring in the scalar multiplication or center value, but we don't care that much, that we don't, that's a little bit too far. And this one called the perturbation, co-cycle perturbation. And
let's say Z1 of G U alpha unitary valued one cocycle. It's not a group, as if M is not commutative. Okay, it's not a group. Is the set of raw doors, one cocycle. Okay, and alpha and beta cocycle conjugate if there is U in the space here, the cocycle space, such that alpha sub U is conjugate to beta. That's cocycle conjugacy. Okay, it's a bit weaker And why we need it is the following. You had modulo automorphism. If you have another weight or state, faithful state, then you have another one parameter automorphism. You will hear this eventually from Stratila's class. Then what happens is there exists so-called the corner derivative in such that they in the, okay, so this is the one sigma phi relative to real line, the unitary of M, such that sigma t psi equal to odd of this cocycle derivative, cocycle derivative in automorphism followed by T, alpha. Oh, no, no, sigma PT. And in your mind, you view this one in such a way that d phi dt equal to psi it phi minus it. And you will have a cocycle identity immediately if you believe that statement. But it's a good way to make guessing, at least at this point. So. Okay, so for that reason, we have to consider this cocycle conjugacy. Okay, so every modular automorphism on a single phenomenal algebra is cocycle, not only cocycle conjugacy, cocycle identity. It's about one, another modular automorphism is the cocycle perturbation of the other, right? And indeed, we call it cocycle perturbation. Okay, we have 11 minutes left. Okay, let's see. Okay, now. So now let's go over to the, maybe I should, why cocycle is brought in here? The effect is the following. I want to write down. Okay. Well, time is running, so I just state a fact about the cocycle perturbation that M alpha sub u of g for all u in g1 alpha the unitary which generate isomorphism is given by the following. Okay, both acting on this L2 over H valued L2 Hilbert space and the U of xi of S equal to U I think the xi of S or either or minus inverse then this U of M this U star equal to M alpha sub U G. So the cross product does not depend on the cocycle perturbation. In other words, that if you make a cross product, does not depend on the choice of a weight or a state, as long as it is faithful. Okay, so that's why we need to discuss the perturbation by cocycles when you talk about the. Now, let's worry about the commutant. For Neumann algebra theory, unlike the Swiss algebra theory, we have to worry about always the commutant. So suppose you are in the following setting. M G alpha and set and okay on Hilbert space H and you assume there exists unitary representation unitary of H which is a covariant such that is alpha S of X, X in M. Okay. Okay, such a system, this, okay, on action, this pi, action H and U, we call it the covariant. Representation of M and the representation of G are covariant relative to action alpha. Okay, suppose you have such a covariant representation, pi and U for G, then you can make the following, the, okay, then, it allows you to consider the alpha prime S equal to odd of US restricted to the M prime. That's automatically generate action of G on the prime and the commutant. Okay. Now you given that system, you make the following. U of G, pi first, pi prime of Y equal to Y cross identity of L2 G, it's acting on L of L H valued function over G. Now, U of G equal to U of G tensoring with rho group of, why I shift to the S, we're talking of S. Yes, there's a right regular representation that we talked that involved modular functions. Okay, then your pi of m on pi h actually, cross product alpha of g commutant is generated by m prime tensoring with a scalar over L of G, so y cross y, that's pi prime, and this U of G. And which is also, you can see rather quickly, this is the same as M prime set cross product alpha prime. Alpha prime is this action. So this is a spatial, okay. Now, this is the commutant of the cross product. Then also, you can see the following, that M cross alpha G is precisely M cross L, L of L2 of G. There, the fixed point algebra over alpha tensoring with rho. Rho is rho S equal to add rho sub G of S on this Hilbert space. Okay, that's the your fixed point. Okay. Now we have to talk about the dual weight, but it's now time is up. So the next bit behind the schedule, but I talk about the dual weight on the here. The unbounded functional over phonemic algebra is unavoidable when we talked about the continuous group, because we have to talk of the real line. And the Lebesgue integral is not a state. It's not a finite. It's unbounded. So we have to expand our knowledge to the extend to the unbounded function called the weight.